All right. Happy Wednesday, everybody. Sorry that my video is coming to you a little later today, but today we're going to be on pages 14 and 15 of our sonnet packet, taking a look at Sir Philip Sidney's sonnet number 39. The background I went over yesterday, this is from a sonnet sequence titled Astrophel and Stella, and all these sonnets are from Astrophel to Stella. Astrophel means star lover. Stella is his star. It's inspired by Sidney himself, who could not be with the woman he wanted to be with, Penelope Devereaux. Sidney is Astrophel, Penelope is Stella. And even though they didn't get to be together in life, they are forever together in art in the form of poetry. So there's that. Our last sonnet that we studied yesterday was him taking a look at the moon, and I forgot to include this last slide I made. You know, if you can recall the previous sonnet, sonnet number 31, Sidney sees the moon looking pale and moving slowly. You know, you must know how I feel. You've been long acquainted with love. Are the women up there like they are down here? You look like you get me. Okay, so I forgot to share this in my video, so here it is now. Introduction to today's sonnet. In this sonnet, Astrophel is still lovesick for Stella, and he prefers the Stella in his dreams because he does not have to face the reality in which she is not his own. So in this sonnet, he's going to be begging sleep as if it's an entity he can, you know, that's alive and he's talking to come to him, because sleep ends up being the cure for all the problems he's facing. And if sleep comes, sleep too will get to see Stella because it'll be in Astrophel's dreams. Okay, so just like the last sonnet we looked at by Sidney wasn't addressed to the moon, this is an address to sleep. Okay, so let's take a look at it. I love this one. I quote it often. Come sleep, O sleep, the certain knot of peace, the baiting place of wit, the balm of woe, the poor man's wealth, the prisoner's release, the indifferent judge between high and low. With shield of proof, shield me from out the prease of those fierce darts that despair at me doth throw. O make in me those civil wars to cease. I will good tribute pay, if thou do so. Take thou of me smooth pillows, sweetest bed, a chamber deaf to noise and blind of light, a rosy garland and a weary head. And if these things, as being thine by right, move not thy heavy grace, thou shalt in me, livelier than elsewhere, Stella's image see. So we're going to start with our rhyme scheme, okay? So you can see that I have peace, release, prease, and cease. Prease is close enough to those. I've got woe, low, throw, and so. I've got bed and head, light and right, and me and see. Now, question one in the packet is going to ask you to identify the rhyme scheme and the type of sonnet. And then I ask the question, does it vary from a traditional sonnet form? And if so, how? So let's take a look. You can see when we establish the rhyme scheme here, we have A, B, A, B, A, B, A, B. Okay, so same rhyme pattern for eight lines. So that's going to be our octave, but I'll talk to you in a minute about how that's different. And then remember, the sestet is any combination of these three sounds, C, D, C, D, E, E. Okay. The traditional standard octave form in the Petrarchan or Italian sonnet looks like, ooh, I gotta fix this here. Looks like the last sonnet we looked at. Okay. So let's take a minute to consider this. All right. When I presented this to you at with the other Sidney sonnet, I talked to you about how the octave rhyme scheme was always A, B, B, A, A, B, B, A. It differs here. Okay. Here is sonnet 31, where it says, with how sad steps, O mood, thou climbest the skies. Notice you saw that A, B, B, A, A, B, B, A in that case. That's the traditional Petrarchan sonnet form. All right. In this particular case, though, we vary from it. It's not A, B, B, A, A, B, B, A. Okay. So that's what I need you to observe and note for question one. Question two. It said, the speaker opens the sonnet by inviting sleep to come to him and uses several appositives. Now, a little grammar time break here. Remember that an appositive is a noun or a noun phrase that in close proximity renames something. So, Miss Gerst, comma, the teacher, comma, keeps making me watch these poetry videos. The teacher in that particular case is an appositive. I ask you to list the six appositives used to rename sleep in the first four lines. And you can bullet, but then I'm going to explain them to you. Yeah. So let's go through them. Instead of calling it sleep, he calls it the certain knot of peace. the baiting place of wit, the balm of woe, the poor man's wealth, the prisoner's release, the indifferent judge between high and low. So there's our six different appositives that are renaming sleep. I want to talk to you a little bit about what they mean, though. Okay. Not in this particular context is like a flower bed. Sleep is like a flower bed where peace can flourish. And that's why we love it. You're peaceful, hopefully, when you sleep. When sleep is referred to as the baiting place of wit, a baiting place was a wayside inn, a stop where somebody could take refreshment after a long journey. So what are you saying here? Sleep is that place where you get a good night's sleep and it increases your wit, your intelligence, the sharpness of your mind. When he calls sleep the balm of woe, think of lip balm, okay? And it soothes your lips, just like an ointment soothes a wound, okay? And woe is you know, sadness, unpleasantness. Woe is me. Like, it's not a good thing. When it talks about the poor man's wealth and the prisoner's release, you know, when he calls sleep these things, you know, just like in your dream, when you sleep, the poor man can be wealthy because the circumstances of this world don't affect you. The prisoner can be freed from his jail when he's sleeping, because in sleep, our minds can dream up a better life for us. And then the last one of us is the indifferent judge between high and low. And when everybody's the same when they sleep, everybody's equal when they sleep. Although I make the note here from a source I consulted that, you know, the beds are probably comfier if you are upper class as opposed to lower class, but we're all kind of the same when we sleep. All right. Question three, how does the sonnet function as an apostrophe, which is when an absent person, place, or abstraction is addressed as though it were present? Hey, sleep, I'll pay you if you do this. Take these things of me. You know, so here he's directly addressing sleep. And that's all I need you to point out for question three. Question four, it says, what imagery does the speaker use in lines 5 and 6 when he is pleading for sleep to save him from despair, which the speaker metaphorically equates to a civil war within himself? He says, with a shield of proof, shield me from the darts that despair is throwing at me. So he wants sleep to take up a shield and give him a break from all the arrows that despair is flinging at him because of the torture of what he feels when he's awake, because he's not with Stella. Question five. It says, for such assistance and help, the speaker acknowledges that he will need to pay sleep for its services. I will good tribute pay. When you pay a soldier or somebody to fight for you, they're a tribute. There's language like that, I think, in like the Hunger Games. I don't know if you're a tribute or a tribune. I think it's tribute. So that makes sense to you then. He promises that he'll give sleep everything it wants. I'll give you a smooth pillow. I'll give you a sweet bed, a chamber that's deaf to noise. In other words, it's quiet. Blind of light, there won't be any light, it'll be dark. You know, rosy garland, it'll smell good like lavender. I'll give you a weary head. And if these things, as being thine by right, move not thy heavy grace, thou shalt in me, livelier than elsewhere, Stella's image see. So let's look at that last question. I said, however, if these things don't convince sleep to come to him as a reward, what does he promise that sleep will get to see? The image of Stella in his dreams. Question six, judging from the reward, why does he crave sleep? He gets to be with Stella in his sleep. And question seven will ask you to summarize what the sonnet is about in 2 to 3 sentences. I'm going to leave with you a song that always reminds me of this particular piece. It's called Dreaming with a Broken Heart by John Mayer. It's out of 2006, so like, I'm thinking like just my post-college years, but there's a very similar message here, so we're going to listen to it. And I'm going to have to move rooms in a minute. My kids have piano lessons.
When you're dreaming with a broken heart, waking up is the hardest part. You roll out of bed and down on your knees, and for a moment you can hardly breathe, wondering was she really here? Is she standing up now? She's not. Cause she's gone, 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 gone.
It's okay, you're feeling the rhythm. I always put this in class too.
When you're dreaming with a broken heart, the giving up is the hardest part. She takes you in with her crying eye. Then all at once, you have to say goodbye. Wondering, could you stay? Cause she's gone, 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 gone.
A couple of another part of the lyrics that I like to listen to here coming up that relates to something. John Mayer concert. He's pretty good. He's a little, he's a bit of a much of a pretty boy up there on stage, though. He's really good guitar.
No, you won't, cause you're gone, 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 gone.
I feel you, John. Sir Philip Sidney feels you.
When you're dreaming with a broken heart, waking up is the hardest part.
Hashtag truth. All right, hope you liked that. The last thing is that tomorrow, April 23rd, is Shakespeare's birthday. So we're going to celebrate by reading some sonnets by him on Thursday and Friday. Woohoo! All right, guys, I miss you. The sonnet pack is going to be due this Friday. So if you have not been keeping up, keep up. Okay? Until next time. Bye, my dears.